And so then the other questions that we thought we might be able to get resolved, and I don't know what happened to it, was would there be an opportunity for somebody external to come in and review, you know, pull those full of years worth or something, you know, just to get the data from them. And I don't think we ever got that confirmed, or it just sort of drifted.
So that's interesting. Lucy is saying there can't be that many private adoptions.
Statistics used to be 90 to 10%.
Well, that's why I was asking Paula to, because what we want to report on now is what we started to meet on the incentives to mothers. And so this was, Paula asked us to meet with her as an agency representative to what her concerns were or what the issues are that they're seeing. And quite frankly, there are very few adoption agencies left. Mm-hmm. And she can explain to you why that is, and I think she makes a pretty good argument, case or whatever. And so just briefly, so we all on the same page with that.
So what happens in Louisiana is, and this is true for agencies and attorneys, but they are allowed to provide reasonable living expenses to moms when they're pregnant. But there's really no definition in the law as to what reasonable is. And so what is happening, basically, is families are paying large amounts of money. I wasn't aware until a story came out, maybe Todd forwarded to me back in June, where birth parents can directly go to potential adoptive parents and ask for money. I mean, to me, that does seem like baby buying. And so what happens is that women start asking for things, and the adoptive couple feels like they can't say no, so they're continuing to pay, and by the time they get to the close to delivery, they're too far in to back out, financially and emotionally. And so what's happening is, you know, women are receiving large sums of money in Louisiana for the placement of a child in a home, and if a family says at the end, I'm sorry, we can't do that, we don't have any more money, well then mom will say, well, I'll just find somebody else. And there was a story that went around the news, I think, at the beginning of the summer, and the mom actually was texting the adoptive couple and said, if you don't pay me X amount of dollars, I'm going to place this child with another family. And while a woman does have the right to choose who parents her child, it should not be based on money. The other issue that happens, and certainly in talking to hospital social workers, is that families are coming in from out of town. They're paying living expenses for a pregnant mom, and what they don't know is that mom, while she's pregnant, is using that money to pay for drugs. You know, the baby is born, they're thinking that they're adopting a healthy newborn, and it's a child who's born premature, drug addicted, biracial. At that point, that family's not necessarily equipped to parent that child lifelong, but they've already paid $15,000, $20,000 in living expenses. So even though technically they could back out and say, we're just not equipped, it's hard to say that when you've paid $20,000 or $30,000 towards an adoption.
Room set up and all the clothes hanging up. I think one of the more important issues that you brought out, though, when we met, was the fact that agencies cannot compete.
Mission-based agencies.
But the number of children that they place is, I think, somewhat smaller. But the mission-based, like Catholic Charities, like VOA, are going to end up disappearing because what expenses they pay is very minimal. And so the larger private agencies and attorneys are able to get a lot more money for the birth parent. Mm-hmm. And so the agencies like Catholic Charities and VOA cannot compete with that. Mm-hmm. They